Item number SCP-016. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. SCP-016 is to remain within the confines of a 5x5x5 meter room at all times, maintained at a constant temperature not to exceed 0 degrees Celsius. SCP-016 itself is to remain in a Petri dish in the containment cube at all times, unless directed otherwise by Level 4 or O5 personnel. Full documentation and experimentation with SCP-016 must be submitted before and after samples and duplicates of SCP-016 may be taken. Failure to follow these procedures will result in termination or reassignment of Class D personnel. Only authorized personnel may be permitted to obtain samples of and experiment with SCP-016 under BC-L5 containment conditions. If an outbreak does occur despite following the aforementioned procedures, directive-based personnel are to implement a Code Sigma lockdown and containment plan. Infected personnel are to be terminated on-site by security forces wearing standard mission-oriented protective posture, anti-biological, and anti-chemical equipment. Should the infection not be contained after 48 hours, the on-site nuclear device is to be detonated. Remaining personnel are not to be evacuated under any circumstances. SCP-016 has been shown to survive up to 6 hours on hard surfaces and up to several minutes in the air. High-intensity ultraviolet light and high concentrations of ortho-formaldehyde solution have been demonstrated to be effective in disinfecting non-organic surfaces. Description. SCP-016 is a bloodborne pathogen recovered from a mine worker in who injured himself while working in a deep coal seam. Said wound became contaminated with the coal dust from the mine, possibly infecting the worker with a dormant spore. Over the next several days, SCP-016 proceeded to infect the remaining employees of the mining camp, as well as the CDC crisis team dispatched to deal with the epidemic. Foundation personnel then took over the investigation and terminated all affected personnel. Patient Zero was brought into captivity and the mine shaft was collapsed by an explosive device. SCP-016 has an incubation period ranging from 24 hours to 2 years, depending on the presence and number of human hosts in the area. First symptoms resemble the common cold and include itchy eyes, running nose, coughing, and bodily aches. Phase 2 begins 48 hours, and consists of a controlled form of a hemorrhagic fever as the organism causes a small amount of blood to become aspirated in the lungs, creating an aerosol effect. During phase 3, the host crashes and bleeds out, bleeding profusely from every bodily orifice including the nose, tear ducts, anus, skin pores, mouth, and urethra, and in the case of females, vagina. Blood pressure skyrockets during the final stage. Hosts have been observed projectile vomiting at a distance of over 5 meters. Should the host survive the near-total exsanguination, the pathogen will become dormant once more, returning to the incubation phase. What distinguishes SCP-016 from other strands of hemorrhagic fever such as Ebola or Marburg is its unusual response to high stress. Should the subject undergo a high-stress situation such as a life-threatening crisis, the organism will change its survival tactic from a rapid reproduction to the rewriting of the host's DNA and stimulation of rapid cell division. Major physiological changes occur within the first 24 hours, with complete bodily reconstruction occurring within 2 weeks' time. Most hosts do not survive the process due to the heavy demands made on the body. An interesting side effect of the transformation is an increased aggressive urge. It is believed that this may be an attempt to maximize the spread of the virus in a manner similar to rabies. On another note, subjects who undergo bodily transformations will no longer appear to exhibit SCP-016's hemorrhagic properties. However, subjects infected by transformed hosts will still undergo the normal SCP-016 infection process. Addendum. Experiment log of SCP-016's transformative properties. Subject D-016-1. D-class personnel infected by SCP-016. Upon first showing symptoms, subjects' quarters were slowly flooded with water over a 24-hour period. SCP-016 mutated into a tetramorphic state, transforming subjects' lungs into gills. Subjects survived for 2 weeks as SCP-016 transformed its limbs into fins. It also caused its eyes to atrophy and enhanced its sense of hearing into a cetacean-type echolocation ability. Subject was terminated by draining all the water from its quarters, causing it to asphyxiate. Body was subsequently cremated without autopsy. Subject D-016-2. D-class personnel infected by SCP-016. Upon first showing symptoms, subject's quarters were slowly flooded with water over a 24-hour period. SCP-016 mutated into a tetramorphic state, causing the subject to undergo rapid muscular growth and increased bone growth on knuckles. Subject then attempted to escape from confinement by punching through the reinforced steel door. Subject was not successful, died by drowning. Note: same situation, two different responses. Interesting. Doctor. Subject D-016-3, D-class personnel infected by SCP-016. Subject was previously a chemical engineer who poisoned his wife upon discovering her adultery. Upon first showing symptoms, subject's quarters were slowly flooded with water over a 24-hour period. SCP-016 mutated into a tetramorphic state, causing subject to grow an unusual organ on its chest, consisting of a chamber and two separate tubes. Organ continued to take in water and swell in size, until Foundation personnel, realizing what SCP-016 may be attempting, terminated the subject by gunshot. Organ was found to contain several gas sacs filled with acetylene gas and oxygen. Subject D-016-4, D-class personnel infected by SCP-016. Subject was told to concentrate on forming wings. No stress was applied. SCP-016 did not mutate into a tetramorphic state. Subject died of exsanguination during Phase 3. Subject D-016-5, D-class personnel infected by SCP-016. Subject was told to concentrate on forming wings and placed an acrylic box suspended at 305 meters or 1,000 feet above a mineshaft. A timer was placed outside the box, which the subject was told indicated the time to release. SCP-016 mutated into a tetramorphic state, causing the subject to grow a tentacle-like organ on his left wrist, similar to a spider spinneret. Subject extended said organ through one of the box's air holes and extruded a long, silk-like substance, which it then used to secure the box to the cable. Subject was terminated when the countdown reached zero and the bomb detonated. Footnote: due to their similarities as fatal contagions that stimulate the production of excess organs, a possible link to SCP-1801 is under investigation. Off the record with a microbiologist. What SCP-016 appears to be able to do is directly interface with the human genome as well as intercept and understand human perception sensory information. Concerning the former over the latter, as SCP-016 breaks down genomes possibly to understand the current organism it is inhabiting, it could likely incorporate the genome of the individual into its own information for use later. This could possibly stem the bridge between how SCP-016 may be able to form gills on humans despite those specific set of genes being long since gone. As it learns more about the genes of humanity, likely it should be able to infect another organism still. It could utilize the human genome to alter those creatures in whatever way it deems fit. The implications of this ability would mean that inoculating animals and placing them in situations where a possible problem-solving issue arising that is well outside their own species' ability to solve could, in theory, cause them to develop more rapidly under the stressful environment into a possible sentient and maybe even sapient race. Concerning humans specifically, the phases seem in line with the pathogen bypassing the immunities of humanity and launching a counterattack, which in itself would be stressful to SCP-016. This may be why, if no stress is introduced into the system of the D-class subject and cortisol with a myriad of other stress hormones are not released into the body, which we all know subdues the effectiveness of the immune structures within the body, then this disease progresses at a rate that leaves the body completely exsanguinated. However, through the testing process and life and death stresses added onto that test, the body becomes inundated with hormones. At this point, it may provide a reprieve for SCP-016 to cease its internal war with the body. In a state of peril for the host and by association a state of peril for SCP-016, SCP-016 will alter the genome of the body and cease attacking the host. During this time, new physiological traits will appear on the body as made mention by being gills, spinnerets, increased bone growth, or even possibly explosive organs. The implications of this being that should the host body and SCP-016 exist and coexist for even a moment, then the organism can likely use the sensory information of the host and even their own brain to some capacity to work out how to best survive the current trial. Surviving water would be more of a cause and effect. The body would sense water, ergo the body would change under the influence of SCP-016. However, for the more lofty concepts, such as forming an explosive sac to blow open a door, implies understanding of what a door is. Or the formation of a spinneret to latch onto a cable implies the understanding of a box dropping the person to their doom. The stress hormones appear key to the coexistence. For those who have an extended infection of SCP-016, they will have the pathogen re-enter its original first stage. Likely, this may be due to the body either becoming accustomed to the invader, a portion of the immune system being broken so that it doesn't attack the pathogen anymore, much like how HIV goes after CD4 and CD8 T cells, breaking a critical portion of that chain, which then allows other infections to flourish, or the body becomes so expended and blood levels drop to the point that it really can no longer continue to fight, and stress hormones would be released from an extended combat with SCP-016. SCP-016 at this current point in time is poorly understood and treatments have not revealed themselves. The next test that likely should be performed is the artificial injection of stress hormones into the bloodstream while also telling the subject to think of growing certain body parts. That may reveal some interesting results that narrow down the variables of how this specific infection interacts with the body and is able to alter it so drastically.
Alright guys, I want to thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed, and I hope you liked that little last part I put. I mean, I'm a microbiologist, and I do kind of know about these things. So it was kind of cool to kind of, you know, like, read about SCP-016 and just kind of discuss what it does, why it does it, and just not go as in-depth as my first channel, but add a little more to it, because I don't want to just read them, I want to talk about them. So if you did enjoy that, let me know down in the comments, that would be phenomenal. If you liked, then leaving a like would be great, and something is a great way to state that I want to post. I will be posting these probably every Friday, and then still doing the scary stories earlier in the week. So if that sounds interesting, you know what to do. Anyhow, thanks for watching, guys. I appreciate it, and I will see y'all in the next one.